5:06 on 550 and 107.1 KTSA. You know what we are, have right here? We have right here the second to last Gang of Four of the year. So this is big. Not as big as these lemons, but big. We have giant lemons in this room. I'm going to explain in a minute. I'm not referring to the gang.
I think that I know when I'm being insulted, Jack.
There's three giant lemons in this room. Let's meet them now. No. I'll explain the lemon thing here in just a second. All right. Let's start with the guy that brought the lemons. Jonathan Gurwitz, vice president over KGB Texas Communications, longtime columnist, writer over at the Express News. You know, we had Kerry Clack on week or two ago.
Lunch with him today.
And he announced he's going back to the Express News, so now I'm waiting for you to make that announcement next. Go ahead, anytime. No? Not yet?
Dead air.
All right. What's the deal with these lemons? Thank you for bringing them, but I have never... These lemons are bigger than a baby's head.
Yeah, we... I was telling you off air, but we have some lemons that grew from seeds that a friend brought from his...
It's been in the family.
Meyer, yeah. We've had them in the family for a couple of decades, and they grow these tremendous lemons that are about the size of softballs.
Not like... There's no other... Nothing we should be worried about. They're not going to glow in the dark or anything.
So far, I haven't had any ill health effects.
That's going to last me the whole weekend, I think. All my lemon needs will be met with one lemon this weekend. All right, so Jonathan Gurwitz is here. We have Cathey Meyer over there in the corner.
He gave me the biggest lemon, so I did take that personally.
She got the biggest lemon. What is it you brought? You brought some spirits. What did you bring?
Today we're drinking scotch of some sort. Cognac scotch.
Very nice. Very nice.
Please partake at the commercial break.
It's optional for Gang of Four, not mandatory. What's been going on? What's new?
Let's see. I'm on the board of the Main Plaza Conservancy, so if anybody's looking for something to do tonight, Flamenco Friday is going on from 7:30 to 9. The saga starts at 9 and runs 9, 9:30, 10. And then for standard time, we're moving the time back so it'll start earlier. So in January, it'll be 7:30, 8 o'clock, and 8:30 because people complained it's on so late.
Right. Very nice. All right. Always tuned in to what's
all
going on. All free. And Gilbert Garcia, who already is at the Express News, doesn't have to go back to it. And he's back with us on Gang of Four.
I'm going back on Monday.
That's
the plan, but it depends how much of that.
Sounds like you're going to have more company there. Sounds like
that's good. Yeah, we're really excited about Kerry coming
back. That is great, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. So what's been going on with you? What's new?
Well, I think the big thing is we've kind of started this conversation series. Like, I'm going to be moderating these forums every 6 weeks or so. We just had our first one this week with Henry Cisneros.
Both of us
were there, and we happened to figure out we were all in.
Oh, cool.
And thank you for coming, by the way.
So we had a pre-show before that.
So, nice. Yeah, just kind of interesting figures in San Antonio, and we welcome any suggestions from the community as far as people they'd like to see us do that with.
So it's an audience, and then you interview the person?
Right.
And other questions from the
Jack
audience?
Jack would be a good guest.
Jack would be great.
I don't really.
Well, it's like radio.
I prefer
you're
asking
not on
them.
TV, so you're
I don't
fine.
Like to answer them.
Yeah, I'm like you. I'm the same way.
All right, so I guess the big story this week would be the impeachment articles against President Trump. But does it seem to you that we have wound up with something much smaller and narrower and paler than it sounded like we were going to wind up with? I mean, there doesn't seem to be very much meat on this bone, right?
Yeah, I agree. After the Mueller report and the months of, years now of talk of an impeachment, you end up with two articles which have no allegations of any criminal wrongdoing. Now, look, there's plenty to dislike about President Trump and what he's done. But I think, there are two issues to be considered. One is, was there a criminal act? Was there something that warrants, other than you don't like the way he operates, you don't like what he does, is there something that requires his removal from office, as in Andrew Johnson or Richard Nixon? And even Bill Clinton committed a criminal act. The second is a political calculus, and that is it the wise thing to do? And I think Nancy Pelosi has known all along it is not a politically smart thing to do, because now it's going to, assuming that they move forward, it's going to go over to the Senate. That's going to get very ugly for Joe Biden and for his family. It could drag on for months. The Democrats want to put this behind them and focus on next November and talk about beating Trump. And then you've got a lot of people who, while they may not like Donald Trump, they don't think impeachment is the right tool to use against him. You've got an election coming up.
So, but how did we get to? So, I get that there may have been some reluctance by Pelosi, but in terms of the way these articles are written, Gilbert, and you're kind of our presidential historian guy in the room, what, why we spent weeks lecturing the country about bribery and quid pro quo? They're not in there.
Well, I think. And I think Jonathan's right. There's no, I don't think there's a necessary criminal activist that we've talked about before. It doesn't, you don't have to have a crime committed for it to be impeachable. And you could have a crime and it would not necessarily be impeachable. So that's the standard, I think, really is abuse of presidential authority. I don't, from my perspective, and I want to preface this by saying I have a pretty low opinion of Donald Trump as a human being, but at the same time, I've always been resistant to any calls for impeachment. I think the Democrats, many Democrats made mistakes over the first couple of years by just calling for impeachment forever, you know, in response to everything he did. I'm very much a believer in let the voters decide these things. But I will say that the act, whether there's a quid pro quo or not, and there's a lot of circumstantial evidence, I mean, from Sondland and others, that there was one. But even if there isn't, the act of a president basically leaning on a foreign leader to launch a criminal investigation against the president's, one of his political rivals. And I would say, just to put this in perspective, if this is about corruption, his concern about corruption in Ukraine, in 2017, Congress appropriated money for military aid for Ukraine. The president didn't hold up that money. In 2018, they appropriated money for Ukraine. He didn't hold up that money. He held it up in 2019. What had changed? Joe Biden had entered the presidential race. And so I would say I don't want to see I think it's bad politics. I agree with you. And I think it's bad for the country. Even Watergate was really bad for the country. It's not a good experience for the country. But I would also say that the idea of looking away when a president conducts himself in this way is really bothersome to me. And I would not want the message to be that future presidents. I've said, you know, if Barack Obama in 2011 had leaned on a foreign leader who was dependent on military aid, dependent on this country for military aid, and had said, I need you to get some launch a criminal investigation into Mitt Romney.
Okay,
what would a Republican say?
So you're saying on the one hand, I really don't want to see impeachment, but this might warrant impeachment.
Yeah, I don't like it. I'm not happy about it, but I think it had.
But again, I'm asking the question. I'm gonna give you now, Cathey. Okay. You're my last hope.
Sorry for
no, it's okay. But you guys are making great points. But my point is, everything that you just talked about, Gilbert, should have about 12 counts. There's two here, which are very weak sauce.
Well, now that the academics have spoken, the peanut gallery is in the room. And I think to Gilbert's point, a lot of this is to stir up the American voter. So how are people going to react to this? Are they paying attention? Are they following? I think it's become clear that most Americans don't understand the process of impeachment. They don't understand what happens when this vote comes. They don't understand.
Why do you think most Americans don't understand it?
Because I think that most Americans hear impeachment and they think they don't understand it. It's a long process. And they're going to say, oh, well, the House voted for impeachment, so the president's out of office. I've heard people say that. So I'm going to guess there are quite a few people out there that didn't do well in civics.
I actually think that this might have been maybe. First of all, can we all agree that the people pushing it know that the math does not favor its consummation?
Oh, they know he's not going to get thrown out.
Okay.
Absolutely.
So then why push it? Well, the altruistic explanation Gilbert gave us, we've got to show that this cannot be done by any president. My explanation, more cynical, we are trying to convince Trump's voters in 2016 that they made a mistake, that
when
they got
you say
somebody.
We, who would the we be?
The Democrats.
Okay.
That they, the whole messaging since the election has been, you didn't realize what a crook he was, you didn't realize what a bum he was, you didn't realize how inappropriate he would be. We're going to show you that he's really corrupt and sneaky and devious. And what they've discovered and what all of the polling is showing is you cannot split these Trump voters away from Trump. Only Trump could do it.
Yeah.
And he hasn't done it yet.
So
if anything, they've galvanized his support.
Right. So I understand your point now. And I agree that that might have been the strategy. That might be a strategy among some Democrats. But as you say, the polls demonstrate that the idea of impeachment is appealing to a lot of people left of center. But the actual act of impeachment turns a lot of middle-of-the-road voters who the Democrats want off. So why would they move forward with an act that they know is going to push the people who they need away? I don't think that's what happened. What happened is, I believe, that the left, you know, that Pelosi has been walking this tightrope trying to appease the left wing of her party, the progressive wing of her party, and it became untenable. She finally had to give.
So she had to give them impeachment light.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well,
and that's how you end up. That's how you end up.
But even impeachment light has the effect she feared.
I agree.
And I would say, if you look at impeachment, let's forget about Andrew Johnson because none of us remember that.
Oh.
I was a kid.
Nixon. I was busy that week. Nixon, Clinton, and Trump.
Yeah.
It looks to me like they thought they were in the Nixon mode, where, boy, when people find out, even people that were with him are going to be against him.
Right.
But it's really more like the Clinton model, where people who were with him
are
now
strongly.
Feel even more passionate, like they're trying to get my guy.
Yeah, I don't know if they had, I mean, maybe, you know, I don't know about Adam Schiff or somebody like that, but I don't think in general Democrats had any illusions that this was going to, in recent weeks, I mean, maybe 2 years ago when they were talking about it, that was different. But with the Ukrainian situation, I don't think they had any illusions that this was going to create a great shift. I mean, people, you know, look, there was a woman who was interviewed a few weeks back and asked, you know, the question that, related to what the Trump's joke a couple of years ago, if I shot someone on Fifth Avenue, you know, my people would still support me. I think there was a woman who was interviewed and they asked her, would you still support him? And she said, well, it depends on what that person did.
Right.
So, you know, I mean, if that's typical of the
careful.
The
Trump's, okay, no, okay, we don't know
okay,
that it is.
Okay. Let me say if that is a common view among Trump supporters, you're not going to convince him on impeachment.
No,
is that fair to say?
So are you telling me that the people driving this have known all along it wouldn't lead to his removal?
Of course.
So they thought it was worth it anyway.
I don't know what they thought, and I don't. I'm not.
Is it worth it? Is it worth, if you're in Congress, is it worth doing it when you know you're not going to get removal?
Again, getting back to what I was saying earlier.
That's a yes-no question.
All right, but I have trouble with those. I would say that today when the Judiciary Committee passed these articles of impeachment, I found myself depressed about it. Even though I believe what Trump did was impeachable, and even though I have a low opinion of him, I was depressed about it because I find impeachment depressing. So if I was in Congress, I think I would be. I'm not feeling good about it.
All right, we got a break here. We'll come back. More Gang of Four coming up on 550 and 107.1 KTSA. Take a look in the 5. All right, 524 on KTSA. Gang of Four back in session.
Candy canes
and so far we haven't solved impeachment. Let's see what we can do with the IG report. So Monday this guy comes out, Michael Horowitz. Nobody has ever seen him before. He's been in the burrow deep into the back corridors of the Justice Department. And he basically did a report that I don't think anyone really knew what to expect from it or would be in it. It seemed kind of underwhelming, but then again, it wasn't ever really meant to be anything but a review of procedures. It wasn't a report that was going to recommend criminal referrals or anything like that. My takeaway from this report, though, was that all of these mistakes and misadventures and incompetencies that he catalogs on the part of the FBI should really bring some reflection to the Republicans, because he's talking about a lot of post 9/11 surveillance powers that Republicans were all for. And now it's hurting or being used or has been used or weaponized against a Republican candidate and a Republican president. But I didn't hear anyone this week acknowledging that before this, many of them were all for the powers of surveillance and data gathering that they were using. Any thoughts on that?
Well, I think that one of the things that, that came out of it, and I think that there could be bipartisan agreement on the idea that the process for getting these FISA warrants is just, it's the bar is too low.
It's terrible.
It's terrible. It was a problem during the Bush years. It's a problem now. And so I think that everybody should be able to agree on that.
And I think now it's so much simpler to gather that information rather than through secret covert surveillance that you can get any hacker off the street and go after what you want and acquire it. Yeah. Now, you can't use it in a court of law because you obtained it illegally, but you have the information.
I mean, the government was spying on the Trump campaign, right?
Yes.
And they were doing it with methodology that a few years ago, you would have had people in both parties saying, we need this to fight the war on terror.
Mm-hmm.
And we got to trust these people. I mean, what do you want? You want another 9/11? Well, then we got to trust these people. And this is what we get for trusting them.
Yeah, well, I disagree with you with the idea is that we trust these people. They have mechanisms that are in place that are supposed to guard against this. And, you know, clearly in the threshold, as Gilbert said, is too low. The pendulum swung too far after 9/11. We're recalibrating. The idea that we have to throw out all these the surveillance tools because of what happened in this case, I think is not.
No, correct. I wouldn't throw them all out.
Yeah,
I'd stop being so naive about them, though.
Well, yeah, I don't know how many people fall into the naive category. But here's the bigger issue, and I think there's a separate. I don't know if it's a bigger issue, but it's a separate issue. Remember, why did the FBI begin the surveillance? And it's all there in the report, and I think it's the fact that it's so plain spoken and it doesn't make the accusations, it just lays out the facts,
right,
is even more damning.
Right.
So if you actually take the time, I haven't read the whole thing, but I've read parts of it. But the bigger issue is, why did those investigations start? They started because of the Steele dossier.
Right.
Right?
No, I'm sorry. I was just going to say that, I mean, my understanding from the report was, because that has been the Republican argument, that it started with the Steele dossier, and they leaned on the Steele dossier heavily in the FISA warrant process.
That's right.
But I believe that the report says that it began with George Papadopoulos' conversation with the Australian, which happened weeks and weeks before the Steele dossier and came into play, and that's what initiated it. I believe. I mean, is that right?
That's not my understanding.
Okay,
my
right.
understanding.
I think you're
is
talking about two different things.
Yeah.
The Steele dossier is the basis for obtaining the FISA warrant.
That's correct. So
the FBI investigation began.
Okay.
With the
but the FBI went to the FISA court and said, "We need to do surveillance on what's his name,
Carter Page."
Carter Page had because of what was in this report, but they never even bothered to investigate what was in the report. They just said, here's what we've got. And that was the threshold. That was a threshold that was high enough for the judge.
And even worse, in my opinion, they were using news stories they had leaked.
Right.
To suggest, well, look, here's some ancillary evidence or anecdotal evidence to support what we're saying. But they had planted those stories in the arms of willing journalists.
Right.
So, how do you fix this? Because you can't have only one party at a time care about this. Right now, it's the Republicans. All of a sudden, whoa, they really are worried about this. But again, a few years ago, they wouldn't have cared at all, and vice versa. Right now, the Democrats, not that interested in fixing it because they want to keep an eye on Trump. How do you get both sides to care about it at the same time?
Yeah.
Well, the flip side of that is you have a major international incident that, heaven forbid, it happens on U.S. soil. And now we're right back to where we started. Well, we need all this
But that won't last, as we've seen.
Well, that's the impetus to get it going.
Here's an idea, not very realistic right now, but you appoint a bipartisan commission of well-respected individuals to take a look at.
Do we have any more well-respected individuals?
That's why I say that. Maybe I'm the naive.
I need to check
the
cabinet. I'm not sure we have any left.
I just want to say, as a sidebar to all these important issues, is the fact that In talking about this story for the last couple of years, Donald Trump threw out an allegation that his predecessor wiretapped him at Trump Tower. The story was based on a Breitbart story, which was based on a talk radio host misinterpreting a New York Times story. New York Times reporter said, that's not what I wrote. And Donald Trump, to this, to date, there's, I think it's pretty clear based on what we've learned from the IG report and everything, that there's nothing to that. There's no, it's unfounded. Donald Trump has never apologized or backed away from it.
In the same way that
he never backed away from the birther theory.
The government, all right, one thing at a time.
Okay.
And I think the birther theory, we've dealt with that. Okay. But the thing about this is, clearly they spied on him. Clearly they did.
They spied on his campaign.
Jack, yeah. The New York Times story was about foreign nationals.
Whether they had a wiretap in Trump Tower or not, I don't know. But were they spying on this man when he was a private citizen?
So it's okay for the president to say that about his predecessor? And
yes.
Throw that out based on a Breitbart story?
Well, first of all, it happened on Obama's watch.
Jack, the story in the New York Times was foreign nationals who were being surveilled by our intelligence agencies. In some cases, were making calls to Trump Tower, and so there were people at Trump Tower who were caught up in that.
Right.
There was no suggestion by the New York Times reporter. He cleared this up after it had nothing to do with Trump.
I don't care about the New York Times reporter.
But that's what Trump based it on.
I don't care about the New York Times reporter. I don't care what Trump based it on.
Okay.
The president and his campaign were spied on by somebody within the Obama administration who shouldn't have. And let me say something else. You've got to maintain a very, very careful appearance when you're investigating the opposing party's presidential campaign.
Okay,
you've got to behave much more carefully than they did
this president
in 2016.
At a rally this week, and I'm not defending Lisa Page or Peter Strzok or anything, but they ultimately were not in charge of this thing. And he went out and said, in talking about them, and they were lovers and so on. And I understand that he had...
I love that you're so offended on behalf of other people, what was done to an American citizen named Donald Trump.
I'm old school in the sense that I do hold the president to some standards. And he went out and said, I understand...
He wasn't the president when they were doing all this.
At a rally this week...
He was a private citizen.
At a rally this week, he said, I understand she had a restraining order put out against him. I don't know if it's true. That's what I heard. Is this acceptable for the president to talk this way about...
I'm sorry if you don't like his style, but that's not the point.
I don't like anybody talking
that way. That's not the point of any of this.
Let me touch on another very closely related issue, and it's something that I've mentioned a number of times over the last few years, and that is I don't think we should lose sight of the fact, whether you're a Trump supporter or you hate the guy, I don't think we should lose sight of the fact of what has been confirmed multiple times, that Russia engaged in an influence operation in the United States, the purpose of which was to create divisions within American society. And I include in that the Steele dossier. Chris Steele was fed garbage by Russian intelligence. It was part of the same operation. And so everything that you see playing out, I wish people on both sides.
Oh, I agree with you, including this argument we're having
right now.
It is the fruit. It is the poisoned fruit of that effort. I agree with you.
That's exactly right. Whether you're liberal, conservative, Republican,
I just
Democrat.
Want us to care about everybody's civil rights, even the people we don't like. That's all I'm saying. We got to take the break here. We'll come back on 550 and
107.1.
542 on KTSA. Gang of Four continues here now. Gilbert Garcia, Cathey Meyer, Jonathan Gurwitz, and before we leave impeachment, which we have to because we have other stuff to talk about. A couple of members of Congress have said, don't worry, if he gets reelected, we're going to impeach him again. can you do that? I mean, I know constitutionally, technically, you can do it. Is impeachment something you can keep doing or keep trying?
It's absurd. And to give you a sense of the time frame, what we're dealing with in this time frame, where it's so politicized, a year and a half ago, you had 11 Republicans, including Jim Jordan, Mark Meadows, introducing articles of impeachment against Rod Rosenstein because he was a deep stater trying to undermine Trump, and Trump had appointed him. And then you had in November 2016, just before the election, when the assumption was Hillary Clinton's going to win, you had several Republicans like Louie Gohmert, Ron Johnson saying, we're going to impeach her. She hadn't been elected yet. Okay. They were going to impeach her for things she hadn't. So that's the climate.
Thank you for that, Gilbert. But again, my question was, did you get that off your chest now? Because that had nothing to do with what I asked.
Okay.
What I asked was, as a practical matter.
Yes, you can impeach.
Can they impeach him again in his second term?
Sure, they could.
If the Democrats don't overplay their hand, they'll do well next November. If they do well next November, they may think, hey, we can go back and take a second crack at the pinata. But unless they have something new, something actionable, something criminal, it'll be a disaster for them.
Yeah. Should the Boston Marathon bomber get a new trial? because he says, you tried me in the city I attacked, and people are very upset there.
We might try him in another city, but then he could say,
would you go?
Tried me in the country where I
came. I think that story kind of went national there.
That's insane.
Yeah, it's insane.
It's a non-story. And where was his attorney asking for a change of venue?
I think the attorneys, the way it was explained to me by one of our legal experts was, this is just playing out the clock. You know, this is checking the boxes of all the different kinds of appeals you can file. But I thought it was interesting that you would even try to make the argument that somehow if you moved it to another state, people there wouldn't be very emotional about the fact that you blew the arms and legs off children at a marathon, right?
So it can be moved to another state altogether.
Yeah,
because it was a federal trial.
That's not how I want my tax money spent.
No. And so no new trial for
hang
him.
Hang him.
All right. Cathey says hang him. Won't hear that too often. We got to take this break. We'll come back with more Gang of Four. Don't forget The Dish is coming up at 6 on 550 KTSA and FM 106.
Without you, I'll be so blue. Just thinking.
551 on KTSA. This is the fastest Gang of Four I've ever seen. This is like flew by.
I'm just making lemonade, so don't mind me.
Cathey's over there mixing drinks. And we've got Gilbert Garcia from the Express News. You read him his column in the Express News three times a week. Well, see, I read it an extra time, so you're welcome.
Thank you for that.
Cathey Meyer, Jonathan Gurwitz. Person of the year, time person of the year was Greta Thunberg.
Mm-hmm.
That seemed not surprising, given the way they picked that now. I would think from a historical perspective, and I know how this is going to go over in this room, really, though, how do you not give it to Donald Trump?
He's already had it.
But if you're talking about the person who's been at the hub of just about everything, every news story, good or bad.
It's going to surprise you. I agree with you completely.
I am surprised.
Yeah, he's dominated.
And he was upset he wasn't person of the year.
Yeah, he photoshopped himself in. I mean, it's not even a meaningful thing anymore, obviously. It's lost a lot of its impact. But it just, I don't know, the Greta thing just feels very contrived.
If you look over the years, I think the person of the year is sort of a mix between the newsmaker, the person who's made the most news for good or for bad. Hitler was a person of the year back in the 30s.
Yep. Stalin.
And kind of cultural
phenomena.
Yeah, zeitgeist, what's happening in the world.
Good word.
Like, you remember when the PC, the IBM, PC was the person of the year 1 year. Mm. So this certainly fits in, Greta certainly fits in that second category.
I wasn't going to bring this up, but you guys were talking about it during the break. You were talking about the Peloton ad. I think people have just about had it. We got so tired of the Peloton story, people were like, talk more about impeachment. No. Does anyone else think that they might have known when they made the ad that it would be a hot mess of debate and social media sharing?
That was my comment. I don't think so. When I saw the ad twice before it became a deal, it didn't buy.
It didn't register on your radar at all, and you were surprised it became a thing.
And I need to be on a Peloton, and I'm like, fine, good for you.
You saw it, what did you think?
When I saw it, I thought there was a I thought there was a problem. I thought they had a problem on their hands.
The way that the guy gave it to his wife for Christmas and
early on and seeing what the comments were, I thought they had a problem. If marketers knew how to put that lightning in a bottle to make something viral that everyone's going to talk about, if someone knew how to do that, you'd see it a lot more often.
I think you're going to see it a lot more often.
Well, if you can figure out the recipe, let me know, because I'd like to take it back.
Will you hire me over
Texas.
KGB? Yes.
Okay. Need a promotion.
I want a big raise. All right, Gilbert, could they have known when they make these ads? I know you're not in the ad business, but I mean,
I don't think so. I think I'm.
You think
with
they
Jonathan
fell into this?
I think they fell into it. Yeah.
And how did it strike you? I mean, you're also you're a husband. I mean, how did it strike you? Is that something you'd buy your wife as a Christmas gift?
No.
Guy said to me, only if they made it really clear that's specifically what they wanted. Like if she said, you know, all I want this year is the Peloton.
I think that's a fair point. I think that's right.
But I've never gotten a $2,400 Christmas gift. I don't think that's very common.
You should. You should have by now.
Our limit's always $20.
You got a skating rink in your backyard.
But I didn't ask for it.
Because don't you think, though, that with the way things are going in media these days, and I mean, whether it's print or radio or television, I mean, you can't just say, buy this or here's my claim about that. You have to create something that...
Well, you look at the Where's the Beef ads. I mean, think back to all the plop, plop, fizz, fizz, all that stuff that we talk about that's not necessarily...
You have to light a fuse that goes out beyond the frame of what you're doing. And maybe not have control over it, but just know that people will not be able to help themselves but talk about what we're going
to
show
them. And
it gets
to that point of, like, as we were talking about off the air, I mean, that name is ubiquitous. Now, so many more people know the name.
I don't think people knew what it was before.
But is it a good or a bad thing for them? Yeah. I mean, I don't know.
Yeah. Well, but let me run this by you. So maybe initially it's bad because it came across misogynistically. Mm-hmm. But over time, if more people know the concept, you get to sell more of them. So they may forget the misogyny part and just remember what it is.
And don't they do more than just the bicycle? Don't they do like workout programs or I don't even know what the company does.
That'll be in the next ad. Yeah. I didn't know how to take this. I mean, I don't want to sound like some old guy that's against progress, but I guess I already do. There was a story this week that said the new thing with kids at Christmas time is not going to the mall and sitting on Santa Claus's lap. Did you all do that when you were kids? Go to the mall? And,
mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. The new thing is video FaceTime with Santa Claus, where you don't have to leave the house. Your kid just gets on a website, you pay a price, and your kid gets 3 minutes of split-screen Skyping with Santa Claus.
Very entrepreneurial, or bad, or sad?
It seems kind of sad.
It's sad, but it's a sign of our digital age. That's how people communicate
now. At least there's a little bit of eye contact there.
Yeah, at least they're not texting.
I was going to say, if they start texting Santa, that's when it's over.
A good point. I hadn't thought of that. Yeah. Well, you know, my thinking was the kids are already using so much screen time, and they're already in front of those screens so much, and now here's another reason
they're going to get out in the fresh air of the mall
But it helps you avoid the social awkwardness of actually being in the same room with Santa, I guess. I don't know.
Well, also now we teach kids not to, you know, stranger danger.
Right.
Good point.
So it's kind of weird to tell them, go crawl up on the lap of that guy over there at the mall, right?
Because Santa's not a stranger.
Or look at the Santa and Christmas Story.
There you go.
That's a good point. All right. And Greg Abbott says that most people moving to Texas are fleeing liberal states and are conservative versus demographers who say the people that are moving here are changing Texas gradually, politically. This is what's going to lead to the purpling of Texas. Mm-hmm. So Abbott has kind of this... optimistic. Don't worry, we're gonna turn them into Texans. And what's true? What do we believe?
I would have been inclined to believe that the movement into Texas is purpling the state. But you know, when I think there was a poll that indicated that native Texans actually Beto O'Rourke did better with native Texans.
Oh, really?
than he did. I think versus Ted Cruz. I think he may have actually outpolled.
So we can't blame the outsiders.
And so the outsiders actually worked against him. So
he might be right.
Could be.
Look at Gilbert agreed with me on one thing and then later agreed with Greg Abbott on another thing. We need to get him out of here before he turns into Rush Limbaugh.
Have a glass of lemonade.
All right. Have a very Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays and Happy New Year to all of you.
Happy Hanukkah.
We'll see you on Gang of Four in the new year. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you, Jack.